This is TK Coleman, and you're listening to Small Business Edge by Ceteris. This is the podcast where we deconstruct small business entrepreneurship through conversations with franchisees, passion-based business owners, and other experts. We learn what it takes to succeed. Today's guest is Jamie Weeks. Jamie is the president of Honors Holdings, which owns over 12 Orange Theory fitness studios in the U.S. Jamie, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, TK. I appreciate the time.
Let's talk a little bit about your background. How did you get into the franchising world?
Yeah, just for clarification, you know, I've started off in the investment business. I have an MBA from Georgia, and I've been in investments my entire career. I interned at Merrill Lynch when I was in college. I then went to work for UBS, where I was an executive director there and was part of their wholesale and hedge fund business for 12 years. And then most recently, on the investment business, I've been at Morgan Stanley for 7 years, where myself and my partner run a family wealth business where we manage about $1 billion for 70 families on the East Coast. So, you know, something that we've always done, we're private equity investments of some sort or kind for our clients. And over the last 4 or 5 years, from working out at either a SoulCycle or a Flywheel and CrossFit, and seeing kind of the growth of what is considered the micro gym, which is not the big box gyms of the LA fitness world, group fitness, which has always been inside those big boxes, started kind of branching out and doing its own thing. And so I'm someone that was addicted to Flywheel for years. I loved being in a room with 45 or 50 people, it being black and the music blaring and all of us in there trying to sweat as much as possible. I loved that feeling. And so about 3 years ago, an Orange Theory fitness studio opened near my house, and I went and tried it out. And I said, you know what? They figured it out. I was on a treadmill kind of in the middle, and the person to my left was walking, and the person to my right was running like a gazelle. And all of us were wearing heart rate monitors that were up on a screen, and we were all in the same area of our heart rates. I was jogging, which I consider running. Most people consider it jogging, but to me, it felt like I was running as fast as I could. The person next to me looked like an Olympic athlete, and the person to my left is someone that was older and probably hadn't worked out in a long time, but our heart rates were all at 86%. And to me, when I left that studio that day, I said, you know what? They figured it out. They found a fitness regimen that is for all ages, for all people, and based on the heart rate, which for everyone could be different no matter what they're doing. I left that studio on a Tuesday morning, and by Thursday, I'd already bought 3 locations and had called my partner at Morgan Stanley and said, listen, we're going to try something a little different. It's a little more unique. I think they've got something. And here we are 25 months after opening our first one, and we have 12 open studios right now. We'll have 20 by the end of this year.
All right, let's talk a little bit more about the Orange Theory concept and what makes it unique. Yeah. First, I got to ask you about that name. What does that name mean? Where does it come from?
Yeah, so Orange Theory is the heart rate zone. So these zones that your heart rate goes in, 84% of your max heart rate or more is, if you're in that zone for 12 minutes or more every day, you get what's called EPOC. And that EPOC is burning more calories for the next 36 hours. So it's a real science behind it. So our goal at Orange Theory is in that 1 hour of working out, we want you in that orange zone, which is 84% to 92% of your max heart rate, for at least 12 minutes. We'd like to get you there more. If you do that 3 to 4 times a week, guess what? Science says you're going to see results. Now, do you go home and eat 4 hamburgers and hot dogs and candies and cookies? No, obviously, right? But if you have a well-balanced diet combined with doing that 3 to 4 times a week, you're going to see results. Plus, the color orange is energy. It's a good feeling. It's a happy feeling. And so when you combine that with the way the heart rate zones are, that's where Orange Theory, the name, comes from.
And how do you figure this out for your clients? Let's say I'm a guy who walks into the studio. Mm-hmm. I'm not someone that's accustomed to working out. I don't know anything about my body's needs. How do you help me find my way?
Yeah, so there's a scientific equation for each person based on their height and their weight and their age that will be a mathematical equation, and you'll put the heart rate monitor on, we'll put it in the system, and then it goes there. It'll track you the entire workout, and then you'll get an email report after showing where you were in your heart rate zones. There's a couple key things that Orange Theory does that other studios and other fitness things out there don't do, right? It's different every day. 364 days a year, the workout is different. So it's really hard to get monotonous, which is one of the things that really stops a fitness regime. I love Flywheel, but I'm still on the same bike every time. The only thing that changes is the music. Well, our music changes along with the workout, so that's what makes it really unique. I love the fact that I don't have to think about it. All I can do is show up. They got water. I can get a towel and I work out and I leave. I book it on my phone, you know, so there's a lot of value there also. You know, there's a lot of other fitness things out there cost a lot of money. And so Orange Theory provides a really good value there. So we've got a really good thing. I like it. It's unique. I've been in the investment business for 22 years, which sometimes doesn't have the greatest reputation. And then I get into this business where I'm watching people's lives change dramatically, losing weight, getting off of blood pressure meds, happier with endorphins, just literally changing lives. And I'm as fortunate as anyone because I get to be a part of it.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you come from an investing background because I feel like just like working out, it's very intimidating to most people. Most people don't know where to start. Most people feel like overwhelmed by the numbers and all the different experts who disagree. Yep. And that's how it is in fitness and nutrition, right? You have so many different philosophies, so easy to get overwhelmed. Yeah. It sounds like you guys have a way of making this feel comfortable and understandable and accessible to the beginner. I really like
it. Yeah, I mean, listen, that's TK, that's actually a great point. Investing your money is extremely intimidating. And walking into a new fitness center can be extremely intimidating, right? There's a ton of self-image and self-conscious things that we're dealing with there. And listen, we're all just human beings. I mean, this isn't really that hard. No one's any better than anybody. I'm no better than anybody. No one's any better than anybody. We all have the same issues. You know, I tell people all the time, you know, we all have things in common, right? And one of them is we all don't think enough of ourselves and worry about ourselves more than really other people are worried about us. And we kind of all have to kind of get over that and realize that it's our job at Orange Theory. And for my employees, we've got 200 employees now. Our number one focus every day for my 12 studios I can only just talk about is the members. And one of the things I stress to my team, then when you make it about other people tend to make it about you. But when you focus on yourself, guess what? No one cares. You can't go through life focus on yourself. You're going to lose everybody. But when you go through life focus on other people, guess what? Other people start to make it about you. And that's when you get the good balance in life. And that's what we try to do.
Speaking of the kind of people you focus on, lots of people have stereotypes about the kind of person that goes to a fitness studio.
Yeah.
What kind of clientele do you tend to attract?
Everybody and anybody. I mean, we are at the every person gym. You know, when I think of CrossFit, I think of those stereotypes, right? Big muscles, constantly talking about protein, right? You know, when I think of cycling and yoga, I have an image in my head of what I think about. With Orange Theory, I don't have an image because I'm telling you, there is no one person that defines Orange Theory. And I think that's what makes us so unique and so special.
That is great. That's absolutely great. I love that. No one person that defines it. Was that deliberate or was that something you kind of discovered by mistake based on who was drawn to what you did?
No, that's who Orange Theory is. We're not trying to appeal. And that's what, from an investment standpoint, that's what appealed to me as an investor, is that most fitness facilities are appealing to 10% or 5%. Orange Theory is appealing to 80%, really 90%. And so as an investor, that's what attracted me to it because, you know, listen, I've got two little girls that are 8 and 10 years old. I'm 41 years old and I can't remember my parents ever working out. I remember being in the back of a 1975 Corvette with the windows rolled up and my parents smoking in 1982, right? I mean, think about that today. Yeah. I remember being in the backseat of my mom's car doing cartwheels with no seatbelts. So, you know, my 8-year-old won't let me pull out the driveway unless she has her seatbelt on. She's completely freaking out. It's just the mentality and the way that this world is going towards health and fitness and wellness. As an investor, it's something that I've wanted to be in the last 6 or 7 years. I've been really focused on trying to get into this business. And now there's other parts of this business, there's ancillary parts of the health and wellness that I'm starting to invest in now and trying to look into. That the way these generations, especially the millennials are thinking fitness and wellness first and lifestyle first. Versus, you know, at 41 years old, my generation, which is, I guess, I don't know what generation I was, Gen X? Yeah, well, I don't know what we were.
I can't keep up with all the names, right?
And just keep labeling people. We were more focused on technology and investment banking and trying to make money and kind of those kind of things. So there's just a real shift in the world and health and wellness is not going to get smaller anytime soon.
My first job after college was actually as a financial advisor. I worked with American Express, and one of my district managers actually gave me a copy of a book. I believe the title was The Corporate Athlete. It talked about kind of taking that fitness sports mindset to your daily work. And I found that to be very mind-blowing, especially since I'm a big sports fan and I take a lot of success lessons and insights from watching how athletes prepare for the game. What are some of the things you've learned about entrepreneurship that are uniquely illustrated by practices of people that are in that world of fitness?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, listen, I'm a huge sports guy too. I'm a huge sports fan. And so you could find a million analogies between successful entrepreneurs and successful teams or individuals, right? I mean, you could take the Tiger Woods work ethic of the late 90s and early 2000s and say, okay, if you put in 17 hours a day dedicated to your body and golf or your trade, guess what's going to happen? You're going to succeed, right? Mm-hmm. I say to people all the time, there's no such thing as part-time success and part-time communication. You've got to over-communicate and you've got to overwork yourself if you want to get to where you want to be. I will guarantee you no one works harder than LeBron James. I will guarantee you no one worked harder than Peyton Manning. And I will guarantee you no one worked harder than Wayne Gretzky. You know, those there are people. If there's no possible way to be successful and only practice part time, there's no way. It just doesn't work that way. So, from a sports analogy, yes. From what I've learned in the last 2.5 or 3 years is, for me to be successful, I have to focus on my team, and I work for my team. I work for my 200 employees. If they're not happy, then I've made a mistake. I got to find a way to make them happy, because when they're happy, they make the members happy. And when the members are happy, they bring more friends. And it's that cycle, but it starts with me working for my people. They don't work for me. I work for them. I got to keep them happy.
Question about work ethic. When a lot of people hear statements like the one you just made about you're not going to be successful if you kind of have that part-time mindset.
Yeah.
They interpret that as meaning you got to be a workaholic and just like work all the time. But I know you're very much concerned about being healthy in everything that you do.
Yeah.
How do you demonstrate that entrepreneurial work ethic without becoming the unhealthy workaholic stereotype?
Well, you got to work smart. You got to work efficient. My best employees, I refer to them as partners, but my best employees are some of the most efficient people. I work really, really efficient, and you got to work really smart. You know, you've heard the phrase sleep fast. Right? Get 10 hours of sleep in 4 hours. So there's going to be times where you got to work fast too. You got to try to find 8 hours worth of the workday in 4 hours. You got to work really efficient. If you're not working, typically also the people that work really efficient tend to be really good communicators. Because if you're a really good communicator, you can delegate and have other people do things for you because you want them to, and they want to go work for you. And that's how you become really efficient. That's how you become a workaholic, but not have to you know, kill yourself either. Listen, I work a lot of hours, and it's really hard for me to say to someone that you can be successful working 40 hours a week and be healthy the other 40 hours a week that you're, you know, living and doing things. And I think that's one of the problems I see in this generation that's coming into the workforce right now is I don't know that they understand work ethics the way that I do and other people between the ages of maybe 36 and 50 understand work ethic. I think that's actually a real problem.
How do we fix that? Because this is a common criticism laid at the feet of
them. Yeah.
And I imagine in your position, you have to hire them, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
How do you incentivize them to do that?
Well, I think you've got to put incentives and goals in place that are, number one, achievable and are financially incentive enough to where they focus on it. Millennials are money motivated, but it's got to be realistic. And so in Orange Theory, I'm willing to bet that I'm one of the highest paying owners in the country for a couple reasons. You know, I understand being in the investment world that if you want to get someone's full attention and get someone's full loyalty, you've got to pay them probably a little bit more than they're worth for them to kind of really feel, you know, valued. And I want them to feel valued. The other thing is that there's probably not many owners that are my age that use technology the way that I use technology, and that's how I communicate with that generation. I think there's a lot of owners that are in any franchise that are over the age of 50 that don't understand how to use GroupMe, that don't understand how to use Facebook Messenger, that don't understand how to do the things that I do. And I think that's been an advantage of mine of being able to keep millennials on my team is that the way I communicate and the way I understand technology the way they do.
Let's talk about the efficiency comment you made earlier where you said don't just focus on working a lot of hours. Don't just focus on being busy, but do the right things. Say no to the wrong things. Do you see any examples among young entrepreneurs of like areas where they kind of make this mistake, areas where they do things that aren't really valuable?
I'll tell you, my biggest pet peeve is clocking in and clocking out and then being completely disconnected when you're not at work. You know, and when I worked at UBS, and that's probably the best example I can use, is that I was probably actually in the office, I'd say 60 hours. But if I had gotten, you know, I don't use email much anymore. I try not to use email. But back then it was more email and BlackBerry Messenger. But if I had gotten an email or BlackBerry Messenger from my boss, there's no way I would have waited a day until I went in the office the next day to answer that. I would be answering it 24/7 right away to show that I'm in constant communication. And we're talking about something that is so small and so short and so easy to pull out of your pocket, answer real quick, and move on. And I think that, you know, for the people that are really efficient and know how to over communicate, those are people that are probably making 20 to 30% more with me than they would anywhere else, because I'm so dedicated to them for doing that. But there are people who, and I completely respect this, who say, hey, Friday at 4 o'clock, I'm done. You're not going to hear from me until Monday at 8 a.m. That's fine. I have no problem with that. But just know, you're probably not going to be a position of leadership with me. Because guess what? We open at 5 a.m. and we close at 8:30 p.m. and we're open 7 days a week. We're closed one time. If it were a bank, I can understand that position, but we're not a bank. We're a fitness center that's open 97 hours a week or whatever the number is, right? So when you work 35 and we're open 97 and you want to be in a position of leadership, guess what? The math doesn't work. Doesn't add up. So the people that are dedicated to me for 60, 65, 70 hours, maybe 40 of it's in the office, but that other 20 or 25 is being in constant communication in some form or fashion, those people are going to do really well with me.
You know, one of the things we talk with our Praxis participants about all the time is never, ever be the last to get there or the first to leave.
Right.
You know, you want to establish that reputation of being there 15 minutes early, trying to be the first person that's there, trying to be the last person that's there.
Right.
What's fascinating about that is because of the way we learn to think during school, we overvalue the mandatory, the stuff that we get in trouble for not doing.
Yeah.
And when someone says this isn't mandatory, we equate that with meaning this is.
I don't have to do it. I don't have to do it.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Right, I'm out.
And that's the stuff that provides the most opportunity to build trust, to build respect.
Yeah, you know, I don't judge people on the mandatory. I judge people on what they're doing when I don't ask them to do it. I didn't ask you to do it, but you went and did it. That's how you're getting judged. I didn't ask you to do it, and you didn't do it, but you probably should have thought about it. That's how you're getting judged.
Have you always thought that way, or did you have a hard?
Yeah, because my dad made me think that way, because if I didn't do something because I didn't think about it, I got yelled at. If he told me to do it mandatory, then I didn't get yelled at. But if he didn't tell me to do something, and I went and cut the grass, even though he didn't tell me to do it, and he came home and the grass was cut, I got rewarded.
All right, Jamie, one of the things I like to talk to people about is what I call non-zero days, doing one thing every day that makes you better. What's one thing you do every day that makes you a better version of yourself?
Triple shot espresso with 3 raw sugars. Sometimes I do it twice a day. I just had it an hour ago for the second time.
That might be the best answer.
I'm dead serious. I'm dead serious.
I believe you. Jamie, thanks so much for taking some time to chat with us today.
You got it, man. Thanks for everything.
For added insights and a full collection of episodes from Small Business Edge, visit Ceteris.com/podcast.